try not to make this too long because the food's already out. But I like to talk and tell stories, so you're stuck with me on that.
Oh.
So last week, a few weeks ago now, went out to see my son in Seattle. And we're out there, and it comes to Sunday, and it's time to go to church, right? So, well, my son kind of quit going to church a while back, so I don't have to worry about him, but it's me, my wife, and my little daughter, who's not so little anymore, she's 17. We find this church, and it's about a mile away, and we take off walking. And we get there, walk in, and it's a beautiful old church, but we really weren't quite ready for everything that was going to happen. So get in those front doors, and this little voice in my mind or my heart said, go sit in front. I'm a ladies first kind of guy, and there was my wife and daughter, so there probably haven't been five times in my life that I've walked ahead of her in the church. But I decided when that little voice in my head says, tells me to do something, I'm going to do it. So I jump in front of her, and see the shocked look on her face, and I go up to about the fifth pew. Now, the fifth pew is a rare place for us to sit. My wife usually leads the way. She's a really, really good Catholic. A really, really good Catholic. We sit in the back of church, right? So, anyways, we sit down, and me and my daughter can sing. I really like listening to her sing. She has a really short list of songs that she likes in church. And the very first song comes on, and it's one of her favorite songs. She looks at me, and she smiles from ear to ear. And I thought, well, that's kind of neat that we go all the way to Seattle. And one of the first things that happens is one of my daughter's favorite songs come on. So then, next thing, comes time for that first reading. And there's this 95-year-old black lady wearing a big lady's hat. And she's got flowers on her hat that I don't have enough time to put on. She's walking like this to do the first greeting. Now again, we're good Catholics. So good Catholics don't believe that Mass should ever take more than an hour. And at her pace, I was pretty sure it's going to take an hour for her to get to the podium. She makes her way up there, and I don't know how many people have ever been to a Southern Baptist church, but this woman read from the book of Isaiah, like, I mean, she was so good and read so well and put so much enthusiasm in that, that it took about all I could do not to jump up and yell hallelujah. And she walked real slow back. So I'm thinking that Mass is about half over at this point, right? And then they sing the offertory song. The readings are real good. The priest does a real good sermon. It's so good, I can't remember any of it, but that's okay. It was really, really good. It was touching. Then they do the offertory song. And it's another one of my daughter's favorite songs. And by this point, she's feeling God's presence, right? So she just can't hardly believe it. We both know something's up. And that song gets done. And it comes down for the exit. The Mass is over. Time to leave. The closing hymn. It's another one of her favorite songs. She's 3 for 3. At this point, I look over at her. She has tears running down her cheek. And I'm on the verge of crying myself because it's been such a wonderful match. Oh, and I forgot. At the offertory, you know, they pass the basket, like every good Christian church does, but they had all these clothing baskets up around the altar, at least 8. And everybody came out of the pews, and they're all carrying cans and hams and everything else you can imagine. And they filled those clothing baskets. Didn't really know what that was all about, you know? So anyways, we sing the closing hymn, and as we're closing out, this little voice in my head says, ask the nice old lady sitting next to you, because there's this little 5-foot-tall, white-haired, perfect little angel lady. ever since 90 years old, sitting next to me, ask her her name. Well, I thought for sure it's going to be Dorothy. That's my mom's name. I'm sitting there thinking, this can't be happening, but I know it's going to be Dorothy. But it's kind of an odd thing to ask somebody their name, you know. So finally, church is over, turn around, and I said, ma'am, it's been such a pleasure sharing this mass with you. My name's Dan. What's your name? And she says, Anna. Well, Anna's my grandma's name.
Oh.
And that little voice, just as clear could be, and you can call the guys with the white coats if you don't believe me, but that little voice said just as clear as could be, I planned today before your mom was ever born. And it meant so much to me. And then we leave church, and I went and hunted up that old black lady who said that reading, and I told her I thought she was the best reader that I've ever heard in my life, and she was. And then I asked the priest what the deal was with all the people bringing up the food, and he said, you got to walk around the backyard. So we walk in the backyard. Now this church was in a wealthy part of Seattle. It was well off the beaten trail, okay? Go to the backyard, and they have 50 tents sitting up there. Seattle has a lot of homeless people. And the homeless people stay downtown, where they can, you know, they're busy, and they can ask people for a dollar or two now and then, and that's great. And the people do treat them pretty good. But they had a whole tent city where these people were staying. And this parish, to get people to come there, they would have had to go get them and bring them to their neighborhood. And you know, there's a lot of neighborhoods that don't welcome homeless people, and this place didn't. This place, they welcomed them. They wanted them there, they obviously brought them there. And all those baskets, that was going to feed those people for the next week. And they did it every week, week after week after week. So, I'm getting ready to leave, and I am so impressed with this church, right? And I'll admit, I worry a lot about my son. He's a great guy, wonderful person, but I really wish he knew Christ. And I sit there and think that I have to talk to him all the time. And what God showed me is that my son can move all the way from my kitchen to Seattle, but he can't move away from God. God was there. God didn't need me. I didn't have to worry. God's got it all taken care of. So hopefully, in our lives, I know I'll forget it by tomorrow for sure, but right now I'm trying to remember God's got it under control. So, God bless our food, bless